Let's talk to Peter Wilding. He's director of British Influence. They're an independent cross-party pro-EU pressure group, and he joins us now. Peter, thank you so much for speaking to us.
Good morning, Julia. Good morning.
Do you think there is anything that would keep the likes of Remain supporting Tory MPs, the likes of Ken Clark, Anna Soubry and others, is there anything that would actually keep them happy in terms of what David Davis could offer? Because it seems to me they've asked for a vote on the final deal. They've got a vote on the final deal. Why are they not happy?
Well, the government said they were going to get a meaningful vote on a final deal, which, if you consider take back control, means giving back Parliament its sovereignty, which everybody claims it's lost through membership of the EU, means that they have the right to decide whether Davis secures a deal which is a good deal. He claims he will secure a good deal, so it's not beyond the realm of possibility that MPs elected by the people have the right to scrutinise what deal they come up with. And anyway, Davis has given that concession, but it's not much of a concession, really, because essentially what he's saying is, you know, we'll give you a gun to hold to your head, and if you don't like it, you can blow it off.
But that was always the case. Sir Keir Starmer, the shadow Brexit secretary, said yesterday after this is a significant climb down from a weak government on the verge of defeat. Absolutely, it's a weak government. Absolutely, it could be on the verge of defeat. But what you're saying now, this isn't a significant climb down. I mean, you either get a vote or you don't. You said you wanted to vote, your MPs who are on your side, you're getting your vote, and now you're moaning again. Is it just me, or is every single thing you ask for when you get it not quite enough? Because what you really want is for us not to be leaving the EU, and you're not going to rest until we don't leave the EU.
I do think it's a significant climb down. The problem with it, it's a climb down which opens the floodgates to more mayhem, Julia, because what's going to happen right now is that people and MPs yesterday stood up and said, oh, hang on a second, what if you don't get a deal? We're crashing out. We don't have our parliament.
Leaving the EU, which is what the British people voted for.
But they didn't vote to get weaker or poorer. I think that's...
How do you know?
Well, because the polls suggest
that.
The entire
British establishment told them that leaving the EU might make them poorer, and they went, we'll take the risk.
Yes, but the Brexit campaign said, don't worry, mate, it's all going to be wonderful. We'll be richer, we'll be freer, we'll be global Britain. So, unfortunately, the people are stuck in the middle of what is a absolute crisis. You said earlier the government may be going for a fall. Well, the crisis is the government is weak. And you and I have talked about this before. May could have stood up last year and said, look, you voted to leave the European Union. We're going to do that. But what we're going to do is we're going to have a transition to the European Economic Area, which keeps us for a while in the single market so we can adapt. But because the people who've got the gun to Theresa May's head, Boris Johnson, Michael Gove, and they are insisting, no, let's get out, let's put a drop-dead date in this bill. We're causing a complete mayhem situation right now because, unfortunately, the MPs, they're not Ramonas so much. There are a lot of people who say, look, why are we putting a drop-dead date in this bill when we don't know whether we're getting a deal? We don't know whether it's any deal, a bad deal, no deal. We have to scrutinise this. That's, after all, Julie, what Parliament is there for.
Last time I looked, most MPs don't have necessarily any particular expertise in trade negotiation. This is fascinating to hear your
Nobody
language.
Does.
Fascinating language, though. A crisis, complete mayhem, crash out, a drop-dead date. It's very, very simple. The Lisbon Treaty, to which MPs did sign up, by the way, without permission from the British people, thank you very much, very, very, very clearly states, you trigger Article 50, you leave 2 years later. The drop-dead date was what the British people voted for.
No, they didn't.
What do you mean they didn't?
Hang on, let me tell you. We all know now that Theresa May triggered Article 50 without having any negotiation plan or any idea.
No, you don't. No, we don't. We don't all know that. She was not able to start negotiations with the EU. The EU refused to have any talks or negotiations or pre-talks until we had triggered Article 50. So she triggered Article 50.
Yeah, but the government didn't have a plan when she triggered it. They still don't have a plan about what deal the UK wants because she hasn't put it to the cabinet, Julia. What deal, cabinet, do you want? What's the free trade deal we can all agree on? That has not been asked of the cabinet yet. It's a scandal. Anybody sensible would say, right, let's trigger our exit and we have our plan as to what we want when we exit. This government does not have a plan.
And do you think? Do you think it's a really good idea for there to be a plan that's like, this is what we want. This is our final outcome. This is what we'll accept. And then we tell the other side we're negotiating with. That's what we want. And they go, oh, okay, we'll give you that then. Is that how negotiations work round your way?
That's how negotiations work. Anytime. This is what I want. This is what you want. We'll meet in the middle. The trouble is, Britain, nobody knows what Britain wants.
I know what Britain wants.
That's the problem.
I know what Britain wants. We want to have all the good bits of the EU without all the bad bits that infect our democracy and accountability of our elected leadership.
I know. And I want $1 million motherhood and apple pie.
But I've told you what I want, and I'm pretty sure that's what every Leave voter wants. We want to carry on. We want to have a free trade deal, just like, say, Canada has and any other country has with the EU. I don't want to pay for it. I don't want to give up any of the sovereignty of my parliament. I don't want to have a court that's a foreign court that has jurisdiction over my life. I don't know what's complicated about that. That's exactly
what happens when Northern Ireland pop up and say, yeah, well, we want all that, but actually we don't want a hard border between us and the Republic. And
I've not met a single person in the know who thinks there's going to end up being a hard border between the North and the South. Not a single person.
The Irish Prime Minister thinks it. People in Northern Ireland think it. Irish business think it.
No, they don't. You know perfectly well there's a load of scaremongering on this. No one in their right minds think that's what's going to happen. No one does.
Julia,
it's absolute nonsense, Peter.
The practical reality here is that you cannot be in Northern Ireland and have no border if you're outside the single market and the customs union. You know, there's just no argument about that.
There's your notion of a hard border and my notion of hard may be rather different. But this is the thing. OK, you wanted a meaningful vote. You say MPs wanted a meaningful vote on the Brexit deal. How does that actually work in practice? Because if it was like the EU knew that every single vote had to go through a parliament that we know isn't representative of the people on the issue of Brexit, it may be representative of the people on other issues. But one of the reasons why there was a referendum was because all the main political parties had totally failed to represent the views of the British people on this particular issue. They'd never had a choice of voting for a mainstream party that represented their views on leaving the EU. And therefore, we've got a British Parliament full of Remain voting MPs saying, we're going to vote down anything we view as too much like leaving the EU. That ties the British government's hands in a way that will actually involve us getting a worse deal. The irony is, the thing that the Remain MPs say they most want, which is what they call a soft Brexit, which is fairly meaningless, but the thing they most want, the thing that most prevents a continuity, a good deal, a good trading relationship, smooth departure, is their actions trying to undermine the government getting a good deal.
Well, before you send the Brexit Gestapo out to arrest them as saboteurs and enemies of the people,
Was that in any way implied in what I said, Peter? No, it wasn't. For the following reasons.
One, there has been a general election since the referendum, so you can't say they are unrepresentative of the people because the people have voted them in. You could argue that the reason why May doesn't have a majority is because the people rejected her hard Brexit.
83% of British people voted for a party that supported the Brexit as an outcome from the European referendum.
Please.
Sorry, did you not read the Labour Party manifesto?
But the Labour Party was completely ambiguous on this matter.
It wasn't remotely ambiguous on it. It was explicitly stated that it would support the outcome of the European Reunion referendum.
The soft Brexit you say is meaningless is in the Labour Party manifesto, which is we leave the European Union, but for a transitional period, we stay in the single market and the customs union. That is soft Brexit. So people voted, apparently, for that. And not for May, or at least
apart from the small point that May got a majority and she's the one sitting in number 10 and Corbyn isn't. I mean, that's only a fact.
It's done the power of good.
I'm not saying she's doing a good job. Peter, on that, you and I will absolutely agree. But this whole notion that the British people have in any way changed their minds, in any way are confused about what they want, there's just simply no evidence for that.
As a matter of fact, I would agree with you there. I mean, the polls haven't moved very much on this matter.
Statistically,
again,
they haven't moved at all, actually. We haven't
Brexited yet. And I think next year, Julia, is going to be quite important. And I think for you and me, I think the penny will drop. You know, if the economy keeps on motoring on, if businesses don't leave, if unemployment keeps on going down, then I will come on your show and I will say, look, Julia, on the face of it, even though we haven't Brexited yet, it does quite clear that Osborne's sort of doomsday scenario is a fiasco. But next year is going to be the key. And I think the thing about next year, of course, is we've got this withdrawal bill, which I believe the House, if the House of Commons are going to vote down, which they will do, the Henry VIII powers, the date, they'll probably vote down, leaving the Charter of Fundamental Rights. The House of Lords will probably say, and this is finishing off what we started, the House of Lords say, look, we will probably say, with an amendment, government, if you have no deal, then here's a right for you to go back to the European Union and look for an extension of Article 50, so we've got more time to negotiate.
Yeah, I think you know what, the British people, it's going to be three, when we actually leave the EU in March, end of March 2019, that's going to be 3 years after we voted. I have to say, I think the British people will have had enough of the EU by then. Peter Wilding, we'll have to leave it there. We'll have a good talk forever. He's director of British Influence. They are, as you can hear, pro-EU pressure group.